Good evening, everyone. How you doing? So my name is Brian Lewis, and I am a part-time faculty member here at Eugene Land College. I'm also a senior teacher at Exalt Youth, which is an organization based in the Bronx that works with young people who have been incarcerated and arrested to provide them opportunities in education and employment. I'm going to be introducing the renowned scholar who we're also happy to have here with us this evening, Bell Hooks. And before, yes, please give it up for Bell. And also our distinguished panel of wonderful men who are struggling to dismantle patriarchy in their own ways. Gotta give it up for now. So the title of our discussion today is Man Enough. And I just wanted to provide a frame for my own experience and the multitude of ways that Bell and her works have sort of inspired me and led me to a place where I could be here in front of you today providing these remarks. So I am a product of the South Side of Chicago. I grew up as a young man who was 17 years old, who was surrounded by many of the trappings of patriarchy and the ways that patriarchy could be tied in to violence. There were ways that I was able to overcome and dodge those trappings. And Bell Hooks' writing and her works were seminal in terms of giving me the tools, equipping me with the knowledge and the language to be able to call out patriarchy and sexism everywhere when I saw it. I remember being 17 years old and going to the Afrocentric bookstore on 95th Street, right around the corner from my parents' house, and first getting my hands on Talking Back, Black Feminism. I didn't know what feminism was. I didn't know what Bell Hooks was talking back to exactly, but I knew that things were wrong in my community. I knew that I had to make a change. And I'd like to invoke the image and the spirit of two males tonight. One is my father. And my father is a man that I come to because as I was preparing these remarks and I went back to Will to Change and We Real Cool, and I saw how eloquently Bell Hooks was able to write about her own experiences with her father, I thought about the kind of man that my father was and the very personal ways that he unsettled patriarchy for me. My father would always combat sort of traditional divisions of labor in our household. My father was not afraid to pick up a dish and wash it, to cook for us, to do tasks that most normally would be considered domesticated or that in my friends' households and in their homes were considered relegated to women. And so that was the first way that he would challenge patriarchy for me. But he was also extremely caring and gentle. And emotionally expressive. I never saw my father raise his voice. The will to change. Thank you. It's great when she's here with me to tell me the name of the book that she wrote. In The Will to Change, she talks about how love is needed. How everyone wants to be loved by men in their lives. And I invoke my father in this conversation because he was someone who I believe answered Bell Hooks' challenge and her call to be a man who's different, to not allow anger to overcome, to not don that psychic armor that so many men take up to express their feelings of frustration. And the second person that I want to invoke in this conversation is Sekou Sundiata.
Amen.
Sekou was a very public figure who challenged patriarchy in many of his works, and also challenged their twin sisters, their twin brothers, imperialism, capitalism, and all the white supremacy that often goes along with that. And I know Bell Hooks has also written eloquently on that as well. In addition to the ways that Sekou was a great personal mentor who sort of deconstructed patriarchy in the ways that he was attentive and listened, and gave me all of himself every time that we would meet one-on-one. He created great public works to challenge patriarchy and sexism, such as Blessing of the Boats. Those of you who know Sekou and his life know that he suffered from kidney disease. His life was saved by a woman who was a close friend of his, who literally gave a part of herself so that he could survive. This caused Sekou to reflect on what it meant for him to be a man who was living because of the graciousness and generosity of another woman. And he created this sort of extended love poem with the same name of Lucille Clifton's great work, Blessing of the Boats, where he reflects on this. Not only in his public works, but in his classroom. I was a student of Sekou's. Before I became a faculty member here at the New School, I was a student in Sekou's America Project class. And in Sekou's classroom, he constantly challenged us to imagine new ways to label ourselves, to see ourselves. He wouldn't let us get settled up in our definitions of calling ourselves feminists or anti-sexist. He wanted us to know, how do we behave? How do we act? And that was Sekou's great challenge to us. And that's the challenge that I carry through in all the work that I do as a critical pedagogue today, who is influenced by those two individuals and also the great bell hooks who's with us here today. So I just wanted to give you those remarks to sort of frame this conversation. I'm really looking forward to talking to our panel here. I'm just gonna go and introduce everyone who's here. The first person is Oman Frame. Oman is a loving husband. Oman is there with the very dapper checkered blazer.
And the
bow tie. That's right.
Wooden bow tie.
Wooden bow tie, yes. He is a loving husband, a proud father, and a dedicated educator for the past 10 years. He pursued a career in education because he firmly believed that through the passion and creativity that he brings to the classroom, he can change the world one child at a time. Please give it up for Oman. The next person I'd like to introduce is Darnell L. Moore, sitting here beside Bell Hooks, to the left of Bell Hooks. He is a writer and educator who hails from Camden, New Jersey, and he is now based in Brooklyn, New York. I found out he lives right around the corner from me as well, so we're probably going to go to Peaches after this for the after party. He is the co-managing editor and partner, along with Tamura Lomax and Monica Casper, of The Feminist Wire, and is a member of a writing collective created to address and reimagine masculinities, titled Brothers Writing to Live. He is a member of the Africana Studies faculty at Vassar College. Please give it up for Darnell. In between Oman and Darnell, we have Kurt Voss here in the gray blazer. Kurt is the entrepreneur and servant leader. He is the chief executive officer at Amerilux International. While Kurt serves on the board of directors for several community and nonprofit organizations and volunteers for countless others, he's most notably known as the founder and lead donor of Cassandra Voss Center on the St. Norbert College campus in De Pere, Wisconsin. The Cassandra Voss Center provides innovative, holistic programming about gender and identity and is making an impact at the regional and national level. The center was named in memory of Kurt's late daughter, Cassie. Please give it up for Kurt. And then all the way to our left, we have Ron Scalp. Ron is a noted American educator and author. His work focuses on urban education, educational leadership and policy, and teacher empowerment. He also writes on topics as varied as homelessness, American theater, and continental philosophy. He is the founding director of the graduate program in urban and multicultural education at the College of Mount St. Vincent in the Bronx. And he is the, let me get this right, you said he is the white dude who started the National Ethnic Studies.
No, that's giving me way too
much. One of the first white dudes to be on the National Ethnic Studies organization, panel? National Association for Ethnic Studies. So please give it up for Ron. And finally, we have Belle, and I'm gonna pass it off to Belle, and then I'm gonna step off so she can take away the conversation.
Cool.
And Belle is obviously among the leading public intellectuals of our generation. Her writings cover a broad range of topics, including gender, race, teaching, and contemporary culture. I also forgot to mention that Ron is in Teaching to Transgress.
Yeah, I was supposed to mention that.
Yeah. The fall marks the 20th anniversary of the publication of Teaching to Transgress, Education as a Practice of Freedom. Dr. Hook's seminal book on educational practices, this week-long residency, is an opportunity for the New School community to directly engage with Dr. Hook's and her commitment to education and learning. And we are extremely proud and happy to have her here at Lane College, which is at the forefront of bringing theory to practice. Thank you.
Well, I hope that my panelists won't mind that they have to stand up, because I think of it as a pedagogical, meaningful pedagogical strategy that we see who we're talking to. And when we're sitting down in these chairs, we really can't see many of the people that are in the back. So our first, you can stand up with me. Or you can stand up individually, however you feel individually. We wanted to start just with the whole question of, these are men who in their life in some way have been changed by feminist thinking and practice, and that they will talk about that. It's great to have Kurt coming from a total business world, who unfortunately tragedy is part of his story, and he'll probably tell you more about that. But we'll start with Darnell.
So first, it's really an honor to be here with you, Dr. Hooks, and along with the other panelists. I told Dr. Hooks, I'm shaking. I'm like, I'm sitting next to Bell Hooks, whose work has absolutely influenced me. The first thing I'll say is, when we engage the conversation of feminisms and feminism's impact on particularly black men, it's often the case that we get a lot of applause. I get a lot of applause, and I often want to push back against that, because we are not exceptional men if we begin to push against patriarchy. Patriarchy kills all of us. So it should be mundane practice, really, that all of us, men, women, should adopt feminism as a practice. And I start there because for me, feminism didn't begin when I got into a classroom. I didn't know the word. I didn't have any of the sort of language that we use to attach and think about feminisms. Feminism for me, or at least what I understood to be male domination, destructive power, was made alive in my home in Camden, New Jersey. I grew up with a mother, Diane Chisholm, hi mom, who I talk about everywhere I go. She had me at 16. My father was 15 about 9 days before I was born. And I watched her most of her life abused physically by my father. I write about this a lot. I talk about it a lot. I'm in conversation with her a lot. But not only was she abused and sort of victimized by the violence that was perpetrated by the hand of the person that she loved, she was also abused and violated by the violence of structural inequalities. She was making minimum wage, probably about $3.75 at the time when I was a young child, working at Bradley's department store, picking boxes from the back of a truck onto the and bringing the items onto an aisle in a department store. So she would do that all day, come home and raise her kids, possibly get beat up by her partner, then go into a sort of county and state system to get government assistance. One time I remember and recall the story of her going to a welfare office and literally being hit with a glass door. And it was like a metaphor to me about the violence even of the state. All right. So we're talking about multiple forms of violence that's perpetuated in her life. And it's just one woman in the family. That's not even a story about her sisters. It's not the story of my Aunt Arlene, who called the house, who lived a few blocks away and said she needed help. And we get around to the house, and I, at the age of 10 or 11, in a t-shirt in winter with snow on the ground, see blood that's traced from the snowy path on the sidewalk, up the stairs, up her stairwell, where she's sitting in a bathroom after having been physically violated and abused by a man who hit her with an object that had her bleeding in a tub. Now this sounds, you know, we in an age of sort of trigger warnings. But for many people, they don't have the option or privilege or space to offer a sort of precise trigger warning to keep us from being violated. So I wanna keep it very real. These are memories that replay in my mind over and over and over again. So much before I knew what intersectionality was, thank God to Kim Crenshaw, much before I knew what simultaneity meant of oppressions, thanks to the Combahee River Collective, much that I knew what all these words were, I knew that the struggles between the fist, the state, all of these things were deeply, deeply connected. And I just said to myself, I don't want to be that dude. And in fact, I don't even know if I want to be any type of dude. Which brings me to the question of what I understand of sort of, you know, we think about what does a sort of revised, reamped masculinity looks like when in fact I understand the gender box to be very much like the prison cell? So if we're pushing abolition to get rid of the prison cell, I want to talk about the other state-sanctioned box called gender. That you were trying to revamp a weapon that was never really meant to protect us in the first place. So, yeah, but at the same time, I want to get away from that box, and I want to reimagine it, and I want to think differently about what masculinities look like. I also know that masculinities and madness and manhood provide me with a type of privilege that doesn't make it so easy for us to give up. Which brings me to the point of self-reflexivity, and then I'll sit down. I mean, in my work now, I do work with a wonderful team at the Feminist Wire. Stephanie Troutman's here, hey. Joseph is in the back, raise your hand. We do this work as a collective, and we come together and we strive and we work to rethink our relationship to racism, our relationship to the empire, our relationship to all these things, how they come to patriarchy. And it's a wonderful group. It's a wonderful media site that was started by two black feminists, Horton Spillers, Tamora Lomax. We need to uplift their names in this space. And the work has resulted not only in academics reading, but my mom and my sisters get to read it. It's sort of the internet's become this democratizing space, right? Where they can get access to knowledge that they would otherwise not have access to. And I do work with men too. Wade Davis is in the back. Wade is a former NFL player. Where are you? Raise your hand. He's a former NFL player. This, professional athlete, this is sort of the bastion of masculinities. And his brother not only challenges folk to think about the inclusion of LGBT individuals, but also challenging them to think about the sort of sexism and patriarchy inherent in a culture. But this work, again, is not to be I don't think we need to clap. Because then that turns us into exceptional Negroes, and we don't need to be exceptional Negroes. Not when we are battling a system that has taken us out of here. That's not exceptionalism. You don't have to clap for me. That's our work. That's work we're called to do. We have to do it if we want to live and if we want our people to live.
I wonder how you do when you're not nervous. Well, hi, everybody. I think it's kind of cool that Bell has assembled a cast like this along with the other panels that I've witnessed this week. This group in particular seems to really have come from different spots, and it's kind of neat that we've intersected in some places. My story is unique. The bio spoke to that a little bit. I'm a father. I'm a business owner. I'm an entrepreneur. I make no apologies for that. I have three wonderful children. My oldest, Cassandra, attended a liberal arts college in a suburb of Green Bay, Wisconsin called St. Norbert. And I was thrilled to have her go there largely because she was going to be close to me in Green Bay. And what that experience did for her, talking about transgression, since that's what this week is dedicated to, she really transgressed, and she went a step further, and she challenged her father to transgress as well. Now, transgress, by my definition, is, I think this is right, Bell, but you're the wordsmith, but it is to, you know, push against boundaries, to constantly challenge yourself and change and evolve. And I would like to think that I was like that anyway. I was predisposed to want to learn and change and grow and evolve positively. But it was my daughter, Cassandra, who in some ways sped that process up for me. As a father, my desire with her was simply to continue to gain a relationship with her, a positive relationship. It was always very positive, and I wanted to make it even more positive. So part of that was this dialogue that her and I had on a regular basis that became more and more intense as her college years went by. She died, by the way, after her junior year at St. Norbert, just to give you the picture. And I remember when she proudly announced that she was a feminist. And speaking about definitions, you know, I wasn't even sure what that meant. I mean, I had some preconceived things. Frankly, a lot of more negative as it relates to, quote, feminism. And my daughter did a great job of being patient and explaining to me what that meant. Bell talks about meeting people where you are, she met me where I was. And then I in turn met her where she was. And first point is that can be a lesson for all of us. And I hope that there's people in your life that the same thing occurs with. But what happened is because I respected my daughter, and I thought, well, if she had certain opinions and she labeled herself in certain ways, then there must be something to it. And it was behooved me to learn about that. And then I did. And one thing led to another, and she was to be the first, she was an English major and an art minor, and she decided she was going to double major and also add women's and gender studies to her list of majors. She was to be the first ever student at St. Norbert College to graduate with a major in women's and gender studies. And she worked in the Women's Center at the college and ultimately was the student intern that, I guess, managed the Women's Center. And I was quite proud of her as she went through those days and, you know, was trying to make a play in life, you know, not sit back on the sidelines, but instead do something about it. But I said earlier, she then invited me to different events, which I tried to make everyone that she would invite me to. It was really out of my nine dots when she invited me to this play that they were doing on campus that she brought to campus in honor of Valentine's Day called The Vagina Monologues. And for a square guy like me, frankly, that word just didn't roll off my tongue. But it's amazing how things transgress. But anyway, not to bum anybody out, because I want this to be a positive story, and it is a positive story. I lost my daughter in a car accident after her junior year. And so, you know, as I was transgressing, and that really causes you to reflect, under the premise of wanting to change for the better and somehow, some way make myself better, make the world better somehow because of this tragedy, because it didn't make sense for me to lament and be a victim to it. One of the many big blessings for me was the notion of, you know, what if we kind of, if I pretended that Cassie lived, what would she have done? What kind of impact would she have made? And with the help of a lot of people, especially the college, we took a building built in 1883, a former church that was on campus that for the last 60 years had been used as office space. So on the outside it looked like a church, on the inside it had walls and drop ceilings and really couldn't even tell it was a church. And I encourage you to go to search the Cassandra Voss Center online and see what it's been turned into. But as the bio indicated, in a general sense, it's called a gender center, but the women's center is housed in that building. So instead of being in the basement of a female residence hall in the corner of campus, it's in this very prominent place right in the middle of campus, in probably the coolest building on campus, I gotta admit. The men's initiative is located in that building. The women's and gender studies academic discipline is in that building. And then various other things, classroom, a reflection lounge that's housed in the old bell tower of the church. So I encourage you to check it out. But again, as it relates to transgression, I continue to learn. I don't look at transgression as being a destination that I've arrived at, or I don't believe that feminist is some title that I've now graduated to or now qualify for. I think that, my personal opinion, that's lazy thinking. I think we should all transgress on a regular basis, hopefully in a positive way. And then do the next thing, and that is, as you're in the midst of transgressing, try to influence others for the positive and try to do something with those changes within you that can be productive and positive for the people around us. And oftentimes I'm afraid that we transgress, and I'm not talking down to anybody because I put myself in the same category. We transgress in a way to move us further away from maybe the people that we're trying to build some common ground with, instead of transgressing in a way to try to grow closer. And I think our political environment is a perfect example of that. I know the danger is you don't give up your core values in the midst of your transgression, which I get that, but I'm confident that there's room for us to do that. One of an example of that is Bell Hooks inviting a guy from a suburb of Green Bay, Wisconsin, who's a businessman, to sit on a panel like this, that somehow, some way, that I have something to share that you guys can take something from. So I am anxious to continue the discussion. Bell.
What? What Kurt left out of his story is that he raised $2.8 million to create this women's center. And I thought myself, how many white men, conservative, Republican probably, how many white men in our nation are having that kind of transformation? And one of his other things that he left out was that Cassie wanted him, she used to dream about him becoming a hardcore feminist. So in this process of raising the money to create this center, he has become more of that concrete, hardcore feminist. And I just wanted people to know that, because again, we're talking about action. Praxis, theory and action upon the world in order to change it. So now St. Norbert's has this powerful women's center that does its anti-racist, anti-imperialist work. And in a large part, that structure is due to Kurt. Oman.
Good evening. My path to feminism was relatively new. I'm not going to stand up here and say I was, you know, a feminist from birth, because I wasn't. My transgression actually took place through the pursuance of equity and justice. Ever since I was a kid, everything had to be fair. And it's funny, all my kids in the class now are watching, and they're saying, "Yep, as you say every day in class." The funny thing is when I started to see injustice happening around me, it caused me to do something. And over the course of my career as a teacher, I teach middle school. I teach seventh and eighth grade. And the most powerful piece about that is they really understand equity and justice. So for them to reflect back equity and justice on me on a regular basis caused me, with my teaching partner, Martha Caldwell, to create and develop a curriculum based on equity and justice. We teach race, class, and gender to the entire eighth grade for the entire year. And we don't pull punches. We use bell hooks in eighth grade, you know, and they get it. We use seminal works on equity and justice because it's necessary. My path to feminism and to understanding the power in equity. Actually came through the process of kind of the violence that's happened to me as a man from other men, the violence that I've perpetuated as a man in the society, and the more and more I was illuminated to what patriarchy does and how this damages men, it caused me to really reflect on what damage was being done to all of us. Challenging heteronormativity, challenging the stereotype that there's one inferior, one superior gender, challenging the binary, the ridiculously, as Darnell said, the ridiculously obscene concept that gender is binary. And I'm actually lucky enough to have to do it every day, because my kids come and they are the people that really drive this bus. But for me, I'm also blessed with having two daughters and probably the most amazing wife there is. My wife is one of the principal components to my transgression. And she is whom I give probably a lot of the credit and respect to, because she taught me more about what struggles women have to go through, as well as the struggles that I have to go through, and gave me freedom to express myself and to really come to terms with emoting, to really come to terms with these things that have always been inside of me, but society had shut me down. It's like, you know, I was the kid that cried and was told not to cry. I was the kid that wanted to empathize but was told I shouldn't. So through the process of teaching this, I've actually come to a much more holistic and real world understanding of what it means to be whole and to be, as Cornel West said earlier, to be human, to understand that, you know, gender normativity, especially around groups of people, is one of the most overused, normalized concepts, and we are all guilty of it. Yet the first time we take note in the fact that when we call a room of mixed group people guys, we are absolutely perpetuating the patriarchal notion that there is one better and one not. So I don't use that. It's the beauty of living in the South is that we can say y'all. But it's one of the things that I have to always, whenever I speak about this, have to say, this is for everyone. And the sooner we start to accept the small things, like the language we use when we talk about these things, like understanding that there is no the difference we have to overcome is not based on, I guess, what we're biologically born, if that even matters anymore. What we really have to start doing is really deconstructing what that power has done to and what that power does to. So for me, it's about making sure this group of eighth grade students who are watching this for homework, as well as watching the other parts of this, that they get it, that they get the fact that it's okay to be emotive, it's okay to apologize, it's okay to really embrace all these things that are human and not gender specific.
If you can hear me without the microphone,
no.
I will.
Yeah.
I wasn't nervous about talking and got very nervous as everyone so beautifully expressed a very personal and a very politically significant and public narrative and question. I'm from New York, so I read the title of Man Enough, kind of like Man Enough. and it lingered with me all day, and then hearing about, I'm sorry, I'm not used to my,
and put your hand down.
being here earlier and hearing Cornel and Bell talk about a calling. I don't have a spiritual bone in my body, so I get the energy, but I don't have those conflicts with organized religion, and I work at a Catholic school, which causes its own problems. As an atheist, and I left a public institution, which was Queens College many years ago. What I wanted to do is just focus on a couple of things that, for me, transgression in and out of the classroom, masculinity, in theory and practice inside and out of the classroom, is a constant, ongoing struggle. It's not about a one-time thing. I've done some really cool one-time things, and I wanted to cash in on that because, you know, you want to feel good once in a while, like, did it. Especially working in education. I work in education with school teachers who often are beaten down just even in schools of education, right? Where we're told time and again how they're being trained. And if we walk away tonight with anything, I would love for you to walk away with a little phrase that, you know, you don't train students, you don't train teachers, you train dogs. Mm-hmm. Maybe, unfortunately, what's been going on around the country for many, many, many years is because we train police and we don't educate police. This is the direct this is the response. When people's trained to see something, they react that way. When you're educated, you're open to possibility. I'm still marveling over the fact that a police officer was trained to stop someone walking in the middle of the street with a police car. I would start from that moment of questioning everything that went down in Ferguson. You pull over someone walking down the street, in the middle of the street, otherwise not doing anything notably suspicious walking down the street, and you stop them with a police car in the middle of the street. Somewhere, that training really fell short. So for me, transgression is political, it's aesthetic, it's how we carry ourselves, and it's ethical. So for teachers, I'm interested, and I think Darnell talked about how we carry ourselves, and it was reiterated in various ways by the other men who spoke. And I see teachers all the time walk into my classrooms beaten up, and they walk in. And I ask them, is this how you walk into your classroom? Because if you walk into a classroom of fourth graders, high school students, college students, if you walk in like, my life sucks, who the hell's gonna listen to you? Trustworthiness is the foundation for a meaningful engagement in education, and you can't earn someone's trust if your body language tells you you don't even trust your own life. I have 3 master's degrees and my life sucks. So what's education going to do for them? When I met Bell Hooks, I was feeling pretty good. You know, if someone told me I was going to be a college professor, I was thrown out of grammar school. Left high school, but very strategically at different times. Dropped out of college, dropped out of graduate school, quit academics, worked in a nursing home, did many things. I was a musician for many years. Being a professor was not really the game plan. When I met Bell, I was feeling really good. I was teaching at Queens College. We met, and from basically the moment she met me, she challenged me. She was like, you're cool, but. Right? And you can see she has her critiques, right? And they're ongoing. And they're, as is the love, as is the struggle, right? As is the struggle. So as someone growing up in New York, I could look cool. I got my toes painted. They're kind of faded now. I got my boots on. I could get away with certain things. So I could be transgressive in different ways, at different times, different places. And I need to be always on that game. And it can be exhausting. That's why you want colleagues. That's why you want solidarity. Today, a lot of what you and Cornell were talking about, I thought the word I would use is about solidarity, establishing it, bridging it, maintaining it. All that takes work. I like work. I work all the time. I'm not interested in earning wages. I mean, I want to get paid, but I'm not interested in earning wages. I'm interested in doing good work. Education is one of those domains that used to be a place where people could do good work. More and more, it has become just a place for people to earn wages, and it's become professionalized, right? And now we have training for graduate students. I'm going to shut up because I want to talk about this, but the reason why I'm nervous is because there's so much I would like to say. I think I have some really cool things to say about the aesthetics of transgression. Right? When I show up at the city of New York Board of Education, now called the Department of Education, and everyone's in a gray suit, and I show up like this, and this is how I dress all the time. It's my little uniform, it's safe. I got a whole bunch of black outfits, it all works. I'm aware of what I do and how I do it. So part of being transgressive is about a consciousness of what we say and how we say it, what we do and how we do it. I don't believe in much else. So that's what I have to do for me each day. And this is where when Bell's work was becoming so important to me, it was the rigor of her work, the eros of her work. And we get robbed of that in education. People now replace the word rigor with rigidity, right? We want it rigid. I mean, schools across the country now, all the syllabi are looking identical. Instruments of assessment, right? Right. This isn't just on elementary and high stakes testings. Higher ed has become nothing more than a field for these consultants to come in and tell you how to assess yourselves. Anyway. Basta. And stuff like that.
Hey, Rand, I just need to know if you've transgressed to the point of being able to look at guys with gray suits differently.
I look at everybody all the time, if I'm on my game, differently.
Thank you.
Okay, we have time, some time for questions. Who's ready? Say your name, ask your short question.
Can I go get my pen?
Shay.
I'm Shay. So from your guys' experience, can you list some examples of how to be actively conscious for, you know, some of the men in the room and women that need to be conscious to transgress? Or how to meet somebody at their level to at least start the process?
I can absolutely do that because I have to as an 8th grade teacher. Because these kids do not understand. Oh, sorry. It's like, Bella looks at you, you go, okay. No, in all honesty, but you have to. You have to actually connect with kids. And I say kids because in 8th grade, for the most part, they're trying to find themselves. Their identity development is paramount. It's like if everyone in this room all of a sudden closed their eyes and thought about what it was like when they were in 8th grade, you know, on October 10th, 8th, their 8th grade year, you might not get an exact idea, but you can remember what it felt like. And for the most part, providing examples, healthy examples, providing an unbelievable, a vigorously honest allyship. I'm vigorously honest in ending gender oppression and sexism because of my colleague, Martha Caldwell. We have that in our dynamic, as well as with my wife and my kids. But in the classroom, it's being vigorously aggressive in pointing out that you have to ally, you have to show allyship, you have to be able to be honest with engaging conversations that are going to challenge the status quo, that are going to challenge heteronormativity, they're going to challenge the imperialist, white supremacist,
capitalist,
patriarchal society. And part of it is actually leading by example. You know, oftentimes I'm not afraid to cry in my class. I'm not afraid to totally break down emotionally when something has happened. I'm not afraid to walk into Martha's classroom the day after Ferguson when I can't really emote fully at home because of the stakes are too high with my wife and kids for a lot of different reasons. But I can totally emote in full vigor about the violence that happened to me just through watching what happened, because it can happen to me. And also to think about what patriarchal system put that in place so that black men are terrifying objects. And it's like, you know, I'm on the campus of my school, I walk around and I have to be happy. I have to be putting on kind of a smile or something so that it demystifies and deconstructs the notion of the black male stereotype. And in Atlanta, it can take another level because of the black male stereotype in Atlanta in the South. So for me, it's like putting on this opportunity, this different perspective, pivoting a little bit so that people can really get a different idea of what it means to be a man. But like I said, it's allyship.
If I can just add to that, I think, you know, in some ways I represent that string of words that Belle has uttered several times this week.
I hope not.
Well, I'm transgressing, though. But really, I think that in my case, my opinion is, number one, you need to be open to learning. And I mean, I told you the story about my daughter and I, but I think that just in general, we all need to do that. I remember many, many times my daughter would tell me something, cite a statistic, and I would say, you've got to be kidding me. That can't be true. Only to go back and find out that it was. You know, some people talk about this patriarchy, and I get concerned at times because it's thought of as a conspiracy that people are doing it on purpose. And I'm here to tell you that there's a lot of people that maybe don't do it on purpose. They don't know any better. So they need us. They need me in this case, and I'm coming from a different place oftentimes, and maybe you would, but it doesn't matter, to help people understand. And I often think, and one of my motivations behind the project, the Cassandra Voss Center, was I wish I'd been exposed to a lot of that information when I was 18 through 22 years old, because I would have had a different outlook on life. Now fast forward to the present, you know, I've been blessed to be in several leadership positions, including in my business, and I'm often having to meet employees, customers, vendors, where they're at. And these conversations take place because it's on the front of my brain now, partially because of the education that I received from my daughter. And she wouldn't have had the facts and figures or education if it wasn't for authors like bell hooks, professors at the college that she attended, etc. So I get concerned at times that it's there's a pessimism around this, and I'm here to tell you we should be optimistic about it. We don't have to agree on everything. Just because you're a Democrat doesn't mean you believe in this or Republican that. I'm, by the way, I'm not a Republican. So, anyway.
So I think for me, the question of, okay, how do we teach someone to transgress? Maybe the question I would like to ask is, what do you need to transgress against? Folk are not going to demolish the thing that keeps them comfortable. So if we are going to have a consciousness-raising moment, we have to develop a consciousness around those things that actually we're implicated in. So what things do we need to be talking about then in terms of the type of systems that we need to be transgressing against? We live in a masculinist, patriarchal country. We live in a country that is founded, its laws, the ways in its cultures, the various cultural productions are all grounded in white racial supremacy and patriarchy and all of these things, right? So we benefit from the very things that we are attempting to tell people to transgress against, the things that make our lives, some of us, very comfortable. So I think the starting place is one of self-reflexivity. And I repeat this everywhere I go. We are very good at analyzing. Some of you hear me say this all the time. When we're talking about systems of oppression, we are very, very good, very good at pointing to the ways in which we're oppressed, the feet that's on our necks. What we're not good at is analyzing the necks that our feet are situated on. That's the work. And when you can analyze that, right, and figure, and by the way, all of us have our feet, our chair, what our will, whatever it is, on somebody's neck. All right, so rather than trying to attempt to figure out what I need to transgress against or fight against that's impacting me, the radical question in this moment is, how can I do the work of self-transgression? How can I do self-reflexive work that will allow me to maneuver my foot or my wheelchair off of somebody else's neck so that they can be free?
My name is Anthony, and I find, and even in my own life, that women have been the light into teaching me, or at least exposing female feminism, I guess, to my consciousness. But I was wondering if there's a danger of instrumentalizing them and sort of like outsourcing that, the work of insight to a woman, and if have you experienced that, and how you navigate that space?
I'm sorry, but I thank you for that. Tell me your name.
Anthony.
Anthony, that's such a perfect question. And Esther, who is here, is a sister. Esther Arma. We talk about this all the time, and I often call it like this sort of mothering, for a lot of men. I'm not using this in a sort of derogatory. But there is a way in which I feel so many times we are asking women to teach us how not to do to them what hurts them. That's our work. And it's hard work, right? Because, and I have to, a lot of my political consciousness, not only around patriarchy, but around the work in the various structural systems, I owe to Black feminists. So I can name them. Like, they taught me, really, how to think about these things. But at some point, right, I feel like there's a need to do the work on our own. That is to relieve them of the burden, the double burden of not only having to experience the oppression that we are enacting, but then teach us how not to, I was about to cuss, but I didn't want to do that, how to not to oppress them. So I don't know the answer to that, but I think the way forward is to say, you know, the reason why we developed Brothers Writing to Live, which is cis and trans men, is so we can together. We know that patriarchy is wrong. We know that we have privileges that we are afforded that just because we're male-identified individuals. We know it already.
Our job was, now let's get together and wrestle with one another. Let's hold each other accountable and figure out how to undo the work that we're enacting in the world.
She has a question, so you can give her the mic.
Dr. Hooks, I just have to tell you that I know of you because of my daughter, who just graduated from Syracuse University. She's a Black Studies major. So to be a woman in her 40s learning about your work, I would say is sad, but I think everything happens right on time. I personally am struggling with this entire concept of transgression because women are even guilty of patriarchy and carrying that and having our own like self-hate and perpetuating this. And I'm a writer struggling to write a fiction novel where I'm writing about all of these incredible revolutionary women, but all of the men are silencing me in the story. And so my question is, you know, how do we do the work to undo this conditioning and programming that paralyzes us? Not just men, women too. We're guilty of it. We're all carrying it.
Okay, nice.
And my name is Alicia, by the way.
Can I get this one? Okay, Alicia, this actually can piggyback to both of the questions, especially from the perspective I come from. I think one of the things that we can also do as men is to talk about it and to own it. You know, it's like own the conversation and then also admit that we're wrong. You know, men and the masculine world is saying you can't be wrong. And that's, you know, it's like that's the biggest impasse. But the second piece, in the world that we're in, it's finding people to take that step that are outside of the oppression. So that then we can actually step, and especially people who are outside of the oppression in a point in which we have a modicum of information that we can then impart on those people to that oppressed group to then empower them. The example I'll use is in class a couple years ago, Martha and I were doing we had a conversation with the kids on gender, because there was a whole bunch of stuff that was going on with seventh and eighth grade boys and girls, and I know that you can imagine the seventh and eighth grade drama between boys and girls was very interesting. But what ended up happening is we split them into separate gender rooms and had them talk about their issues. Martha was with the women first, I was with the young men first, and we talked about it. I was getting nowhere because I was annoyed with them, because I know I'm in the oppression. I mean, I'm a beneficiary of patriarchy. So I was like, you know, you guys you're wasting my time, yada, yada, yada. And kind of we switched roles at one point. When we switched roles, I was outside of the oppression, so I was able to bring what they were really feeling to a surface and gave them an audience that was receptive, that didn't represent the internalized oppression. So what ended up happening is they wrote this incredibly powerful letter to the boys, and when they read it to them, it broke them down. And it's not because I did that, but the only thing that I can be a part of was being a gatekeeper to open that, you know, to let them really fully express themselves without bounds, and with me as a man encouraging them to take those risks and to push it. So it's like having someone read your work that's like, yo, you need to keep going with this. How come you have all these guys? You know, it's having someone outside the oppression kind of re-energize you.
If I could just add to that one, and then try to go backwards to the original question also about practical stuff. In terms, going back to Bell's book, the subtitle of which is "Education is the Practice of Freedom," which is from Paulo Freire's book, a chapter in one of his books. That there's that kind of Buddhist spin on practice, right? On that, but there's also practice, right? And meaning you don't always get it right, and there are pitfalls and habits. And not just comfort, but where we go when we're in fear, all directing us, silencing us, or making us loud. And so some of the things that, you know, you do in one setting to confront, address, and overcome a particular oppressive moment might not be that same strategy in another setting. That's why, again, I will repeat the significance of a work like Teaching to Transgress as an educational strategy, as an educational commitment to an ongoing way of viewing this here, there, and everywhere, so that when people start talking about prosperity and they slip into that kind of greed mode, then you can interrupt that by talking about ambition. And ambition, kids are afraid to talk about being ambitious, but they have no inhibition about talking about being greedy. They want this, they want that. And it's not just because I like philosophy that I'm interested in distinctions, but we should own our ambitions and own where we conflict, or come into conflict with people, and give thanks and ownership and appreciation and gratitude to those that help us along the way. That's part of education. That kind of reciprocity happens with mutual respect. And again, so I just want to go back to the power of Teaching to Transgress historically as an announcement at a time when a lot of people were reforming education, and in the name of reforming, which we're getting again, are actually undermining the very power of education as the practice of freedom.
Many of you know that throughout the days I've been saying patriarchy has no gender. So I repeat that to remind us that we're not talking, to talk about men is not to behave as though men are the only people who push patriarchy, who benefit from patriarchy, that patriarchy is there among all of us. There's a question over here. Your name? Your name?
Jalise. Hi. My question is for the educators of grade school children. I work in schools too, but not directly as a teacher. But I am really interested in how we affect children. In Oman, you talked about being like explicitly honest with your students about how you're going to challenge them throughout the year, and that's your personal mission, therefore it's going to be embedded in your teaching strategies. And so I guess my question is, what tools, because I've seen a lot of programs create really safe spaces for children to challenge, the adolescents to challenge themselves, and then they become empowered, and that's great. And then they go out into their life outside of that classroom, and they have to deal with people pushing back against that. And so I'm wondering what tools you give to students, and in what language you give to students to help them navigate their worlds outside of the space that you create.
The major tool we give them is the process of identity. It's being self-reliant on who they are and then the community that they come from. My school by no means is the most super diverse school. So it's giving them tools to really anchor themselves on their identity. And we do that through honest conversations, presentation of information from scholarly works. And you can find that all the way down. Especially with elementary students, it's through books, through picture books, because there's a lot of information within those picture books that can really open doors for kids to identify themselves in those books and identify their feelings. Especially around masculinity and patriarchy, you find books that challenge heteronormativity, that challenge what it really means to be a man, that gets kids to really open up around their pain and the social emotional violence that's happening every day when they play video games or when they go to, when they walk in the street or then listen to music. You know, it's putting different things in their path to listen to and to watch and to be a part of that are directly in, that are countering the situation. Another thing is we don't necessarily provide safe spaces. We provide areas, and Belle and Laverne said this yesterday, and I'm totally going to say this from now on, is we provide areas for risk and appropriate risk-taking. We do a lot of work with cognitive dissonance, so we get kids to understand what that means, and a lot of times, I use the example of my 8-month-old who cannot walk, but she stands up and she falls down. What does she want to do? She wants to stand up again. And she's going to fall, and she's going to fall, and she's going to fall, but eventually she will start to walk. And from walking comes running, and from running comes you know, there, here and beyond. So what we often try to tell little people is it's not going to be easy. Understand patience and mindfulness and being where you are and being present. And the concrete stuff I would say is to start with books, start with models in your community, bring in people that can address this from a non-traditional standpoint. And oftentimes it's like, you know, challenging patriarchy is going to be presenting options for kids to pick when they're young or when they can really, when they're in the most just seeking part of their lives. I hope that answers some of it.
There was a question over here.
Hi. I'm just reflecting a little bit on what
your
you
name?
Ayana. My name is Ayana. I'm reflecting a little bit on what you said, Ron, actually, at the end of your introduction, and you were saying, you know, one way that you transgress is just in the way that you present yourself and in your dress. And I thought it was really interesting because I graduated from Lang in May, and I've entered a very professional white-collar world that frustrates me a lot, but I also excites me, but it's just it frustrates me. And I was actually just talking to my colleague today, Diallo, and I was saying, I can't believe you're doing this suit thing. Like, I can't believe, like knowing you're a progressive dude, like, I can't believe you're even doing this. And he was like, my name is Diallo. Like, what do you expect? And I was just thinking about that, like, privilege that comes with being able to decide that, you know, in this space, I'm gonna paint my toenails, or in this space, I'm gonna wear my beads, I'm gonna be different, because it's a decision that I feel like I can't make, and I know that my friend here can't make either in these spaces, because in a way, even though it's a form of transgression to just be in that space, but it doesn't feel like enough to me. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, I'm in this space, but that just feels like a basic thing. Of course I should be here. That's not really transgression, but, you know, it is transgression because we are underrepresented. So I know this kind of, it's kind of a comment, kind of a question, but I kind of wanted y'all to even talk a little bit more about that. And just like privilege as it comes into this idea of transgression and being in these spaces that, like, sometimes you don't belong.
Well, I think that in any space, we still have choice. I mean, you can decide to do dress however you want. The question becomes the consequences. That if we take a certain action, are we willing to bear the consequences of that action? So that taking an action in and of itself doesn't have to be an expression of privilege, because the consequence of that action may not be privileging at all. And I think that a lot of times, as people of color, we don't do certain things because we do inhabit spaces of great fear and dread, of consequences. And we don't evaluate our optimal well-being around what is this action that I should take. In a sense, often we give up way more often than we should out of that fear, that if I don't conform and I don't, you know, totally conform, I will not be able to succeed. So that for us all, then we have to decide, well, what are you trying to succeed at? You know, if you're trying to succeed at entering this norm culture, then yes, there are certain standards that you're going to have to abide by. But if you have a different sense of how you want to make it in the world, or how you want to push against a system, I mean, throughout my years in academia, I pushed against. But that has meant that, believe it or not, I don't make a lot of money at my academic job. Because you can't keep pushing. A lot. People say, oh, you must have had all kind of job offers. I said, you know, what I get is bell hooks is difficult. She stirs up trouble. You wouldn't want to have her on your faculty, et cetera, et cetera. So that we don't necessarily, like, For my own life and my own self, I made certain choices, and I have to bear the consequences of those choices.
I totally agree with that, and I do occupy a lot of positions of privilege, right? But what I didn't say, and because it's not necessary, is that I have done things that have cost me money, relationships, in the name of embracing a certain kind of lived, you know, a vigilance towards this. But
you know, a place of privilege. So I get to be like the heterosexual dude walking around with his toenails painted. But when I'm on 191st Street on the one train and school gets out, they're not going, oh, there's a dude from, you know, Union Square, you know, playing with this stuff. They go, faggot. And that's their response. And I do shit like, how about those Yankees last night? And I ain't go to work. And then suddenly me with my little flip-flops looks not so, you know, tough. And I have to figure out, and I change my posture. And that's in this instance. So part, if you're going to be transgressive, that's why I said it's aesthetic, it's political, and it's ethical. And if you forget any one of those aspects of it, I think you're not being true to the work of transgression. And of course, like anything else in art culture that gets appropriated and commodified, even transgression. Hell, I used to see people with tattoos when I was a kid, and I would go like, right on, you know, or a ponytail. I remember the first time I got my ass kicked by a cowboy. He had a ponytail. I was going, hey, friend.
Okay.
So this is taking a turn. So I realized that my only that I have no intimate interactions with people who are male identified in my life, and so the street becomes a really important place, and the only place in which I'm interacting with men, really. And so I was wondering if you could shed some insight, and it obviously is a very contemptuous place of interaction. So I was wondering if you could shed some insight as to how I can use that space to be doing some work, as that's the only space in which I'm interacting with men.
Darnell.
Yeah, I don't, thank you for that. I'm thinking about, as you're mentioning this, the most recent incidents of women who had been brutally attacked. One in the Bronx, most recently, who was attacked with a knife. And another sister who was shot by a male perpetrator after both of them had rejected the advances of men. So the question of, like, how do you use the street becomes a really hard one, because that shouldn't be your work, right? That shouldn't be your work.
But then there's like, and then I'm like, okay, well, then what?
Yeah, I think the other question, I think, is a question, is a one of equity and justice, a one of an ethical one, and that is, what is our work to ensure that you don't have to work to save yourself? That's not yours alone. And I think that the fact that we don't even talk about these women and make them the center of our racial justice frameworks, of our progressive politics, we let them, they are, this is mundane attacks. I mean, we get snippets every now and then, but this is constant. The ways you're catcalled on the streets, how that catcall is rejected and it ends up and translates into somebody's death, and nobody's going to march, nobody's going to talk up. I have to have my sister to write. Look, we know how this goes. You have to push us to work. That's our responsibility, and I mean that's all of our responsibility. And I think that's the way to, I think we should respond to that.
This one, you need the mic?
Thank you. My name's Esther. I wanted to ask you all, including you, Dr. Hooks, to talk specifically about contradiction. When I listened to talk of the importance of transgression, I feel sometimes that there is this acquisition of a fluency in language when it comes to the ideology that is neglected when it comes to having to negotiate the resistance of practicing that. what does it mean for you all to have reframed the idea of success if the thing that you're pushing up against is the thing that gives you privilege? And how do you negotiate that space? Because my concern, I do this work called emotional justice, which is about how do you navigate legacies of untreated trauma and transform yourself and the relationships that you create and encounter. And the thing that concerns me, I do work with men and women, is this nurtured ideology but a neglected emotionality. And the space between those two things is the world in which you live. And so I think about the applause that you talk about and the ways which we, all of us, applaud men particularly showing up in these spaces articulating this ideology, but in their practice, when they are coming up against the resistance from women colleagues or other people they work with, the way in which you negotiate that resistance for me becomes about the practical work of being transgressive when it's always risky. You know, there are very few circumstances in which for a woman of color, it isn't a risk. And so I think it's, I hear somebody talk about creating spaces of risk and think, I walk in that. That's the world in which I live. Do you know what I mean? And so negotiating risk is a breathing space for a black woman, for a black girl. And so I wonder about, does transgression mean for you a reframing of success? And what is that reframe? And how do you navigate those contradictions and that resistance?
Well,
I was like, who's on this one? Because that's why everyone's really excited.
Well, I mean, that was a lot said. I mean, the fact is we are all living in the space of contradictions. And so the question is always, how do we navigate ourselves in those contradictions? I have had my difficulties with academe my whole career, but I have yet to completely remove myself from academe. And it's not because I can't. It's because there's something that keeps me in this educational system, even though I'm constantly also in tension, conflict, and resistance within that system. So that I think that part of the kind of transgression we're talking about is precisely that practice in the actual worlds that we live within that is so crucial to us. All of these men here work in a practical way in the worlds that they live within to bring greater knowledge of feminism, of patriarchy, and that may not mean that they don't screw up. I mean, Ron and I have had our arguments over the years when I feel like he isn't comprehending that he's operating from his white male privilege space. And it's a constant effort to be vigilant, to respect each other. You know, Ron does like to talk a lot. And I remember the first time he came to Berea, and, you know, it's like we were giving this talk together, and Ron just kept talking and talking. And I said, it was when white men can't jump or whatever. I was like, white men can ramble. People got very upset that I wasn't going along with the bourgeois decorum of academe, where you don't make a critical comment about a guest. And then as soon as we were out of the building, I was like, Ron, what the hell was that? I mean, what the fuck was going on with you? Blah, 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 blah. And it's interesting because Ron talked about, I don't know if you remember this, the tension of being there with bell hooks and his wanting to be so good, so perfect, that he really lost a sense of his timing, of space, etc. So I think one thing that we have to, I think that Buddhism brings for me in life is the will to be compassionate towards people as they are going through transformations, as they are being challenged by something that rocks them to the core. When you don't realize you're participating in an exploitation or an oppression of someone or hurting someone, how to face that and how to be confronted in a way that is not re-wounding and re-traumatizing. There was a question over, there you are, sweetheart. I'm sorry, thank you for waiting.
Sometimes too long could be a minute too long.
I don't know what that means.
Hello, I'm Bria. My question is, when talking about not necessarily feminism, but patriarchy, there tends to be a victim versus a, you know, person who is doing, who is victimizing another person. How do you get away from that when, in actuality, yeah, there's a certain type of gender who is dominating a patriarchal society, but there are also women who perpetuate, or another gender who perpetuate that and help it along the way. How do you let go of that victim blaming, or not the victim blaming, but more like becoming a victim and me looking at you as the person who's hurting me, you know?
Well, I think that the best way to counter blame is always accountability. Mm-hmm. To look at what is my accountability in a circumstance. I mean, I've talked a lot in these past few days about having once been a very pro-Hillary Clinton supporter, but finding at this stage of life and the stage of her politics that I can no longer be a Hillary Clinton supporter in the name of feminism. There are certain things that I don't want to co-sign in the name of feminism that I think are militarist, imperialist, white supremacist, whether they are conducted by women or men. And I think that having to go through those changes and having to be compassionate towards yourself, because there are a lot of women that are feeling political turmoil right now because of our history of supporting feminists, supporting a woman, looking forward to the day when we can say, oh, we have a woman president. And that constant challenge about identity politics versus who are you and what do you stand for? I mean, that's why Baldwin says, it's not a question of whether you're gay or straight or black or white. What do you stand for? Who are you? How can you know that and operate from that position of power? And I think that's what Oman was saying, that they hope to give the children the strength to operate from that position of power, of self-knowledge, of self-love. Well, we have run out of time. And I'm sorry, and I have to always remind us that there are the people who work behind the scenes, staying late, doing the work of making it possible for us to sit and talk. And partially out of respect for them, we have to abide by time boundaries. Thank you all for coming.
Of course, my memory is about that.